Joining me on stage, the one, the only, the incomparable, Mr. Neal Adams. Gave us Superman versus Muhammad Ali and so many other things. Yeah, go for it. Make yourself comfortable. This is for you.
Got little rollers on.
Yeah, they get away from you. They run away.
Greetings.
Welcome back.
Are you guys just here instead of out there buying stuff?
They're comic books you could be buying. Speaking of comic books, a friend of mine, an employee of yours, Val Merrick, has told me many stories about the days of continuity beginning and
being... The thing to remember is nobody was ever an employee of continuity.
Oh.
They worked at the studio, they rented space, and they did their own work, and they did work for us.
Neal's my favorite improv comedy partner because he takes all of my leads. So why did continuity become a thing? Why, did you feel there was a need for this? Was this something that people came to you saying, you know, we need space, we need a place to get together and
no,
work?
It was because Carmine Infantino was an asshole. And he said he didn't need me up at DC Comics anymore, and I agreed with him. Because new artists were coming in. And I had pretty much done my job, and that was to help to relaunch DC Comics so it could compete with Marvel Comics. Now, very few of you are old enough to remember those days, but there was a time when Marvel Comics got so good, so fast, that they were beating the crap, pardon me, beating the hell out of DC Comics. So I was the secret weapon. I did all the covers and I did all the new stuff. And after a while, we got new artists in, and I was such a pain in the butt at DC Comics that they sort of like suggested that maybe they didn't need me anymore. And so I rented a studio on 48th Street, and all the freelancers of the industry decided to come and hang out at my studio. And so they took desk space, and basically this studio became the, I don't know, the revolutionary center of the industry. We always had a fresh pot of coffee. We always had a few Danishes lying around. And revolution was in the air. So, and you can talk to, Howard Chaykin is here. There's a couple of guys here. And if you talk to them, they will tell you a little bit about Continuity Studios. And at Continuity Studios, yeah, you got, sorry about that. I was about to warn you, but I think it would have panicked you. But what happened was that there was Marvel Comics where you couldn't go and hang out. There was DC Comics where you could hang out in the lunchroom, but they'd spy on you. And then there was Continuity, which is sort of in between them. So everybody came and had a cup of coffee, smoked a joint.
To the past, it happened. Statute of limitations is probably out.
I didn't say that. Did I say smoke a joint?
I think I said that actually.
No,
I'm sorry. You didn't correct me, but
in the back.
It's okay.
Now it is. And basically these were the young lions. These were the new guys in the industry. This is Bernie Wrightson, Alan Weiss, Howard Chaykin. Of course, Howard never smoked a joint in his life. I only say that because Howard's here. But Jeff Jones, pretty much Gray Morrow, everybody who was new in the industry hung out at Continuity. And we had to pretty much chase them out with a stick because they were such a pain in the butt. But they wanted to know how we could change the industry. And so that became the center of the change. We created a group called the Krusty Bunkers. Krusty Bunkers was created when somebody did a good pencil job and we didn't want it to go to Vinnie Coletta to ink. And so we volunteered to ink it at Continuity and we would pass the pages out to whomever came in since everybody in the industry was better than Vinnie Coletta. Who has a reputation of ruining more books than any five inkers could ink. So we would rescue the books, and I can recall In fact, Howard's Fafford and the Gray Mauser was inked by the Krusty Bunkers. Frank Brunner's Dr. Strange was inked by the Krusty Bunkers. And if somebody were to ask me how the Krusty Bunkers work, I would have to say it didn't work. The Krusty Bunkers were a loose conglomeration of people who happened to drop into the studio, and as the price of dropping into the studio, they had to sit down at a desk and ink backgrounds or figures or whatever just to get the job done. And then they would list on a little sheet of paper what they did so that when the paycheck came in, which was very small, we would break it up and pay people, you know, $5.80 or $14 or whatever it was, according to how much work they did on a page. But we got those pages done, and we got the pages in, and we established a new standard, and the new standard was, don't give good work to lousy inkers.
Of the guys that showed up and hung out and wouldn't leave, is there anybody in particular of that, you know, first wave of folks who came in that really impressed you with their line work, their skill, their work ethic? You know, you named off some of these literal legends, you know, guys like Bernie Wrightson. Were there any of them that you personally particularly, you know, really really dug what they put on the page?
No.
I mean, not compared to Neal.
No, they're all pains in the ass, pretty much. I mean, you had a bunch of young artists who were, one way and another, they were a pain in the ass. I mean, you couldn't escape that. Guys would stay late at night and want to smoke joints. And it's like, no, we can't do that. We have to work. Oh, come on, let's turn the lights out and have some donuts. No, we're not going to turn the lights out and have donuts and smoke your joint. We're going to sit down and do work. And then when we're done, we're going to leave. Aw, oh, come on, Neal. Schmucks. Jerks. I mean, just giant pains in the butt, really. Very hard to get any work done in this place. And I basically had to, you know, threaten them. I said, I flush your joints down the toilet. And I did. It was great. They'd be screaming. Don't! There it goes. I know, it sounds like I'm making a joke. It's not a joke. I really, really did this. And each one of them, the thing about it that you have to understand is when you're in a studio filled with semi-geniuses, they're also semi-schmucks. It's, you can't avoid the schmuckness with the genius. You know, they come as a package. So, you know, my partner, Dick Giordano, would leave at 4 o'clock and leave me alone with these jerks. He'd say, how do you put up with these idiots? And I'd say, Dick, they turn out good work. He'd say, yeah, but then look, they're schmucks. All right, they are, you're right. But we saved a lot of work and we did a lot of good stuff. But even the nicest guys would be schmucks. You know, like you get the good-looking guy, handsome-looking guy, right? Talented and handsome. Come up with a girl. Don't come up with a girl. You just like distract everybody because it'd be a pretty girl. So what do you do with a guy who wants to have his pretty girlfriend in a studio with a bunch of very, very horny guys? It's just trouble. Just take her out of here. She's too cute. Yeah, but she's cute. I know, that's the point. And they would come up and they mooch. You know, like I come in the morning, right? This is not stuff you want to hear, okay? But I'm sorry. And I apologize.
It's all my fault, to be honest.
It really is.
I brought us here.
So I come in the morning, right? And I make a pot of coffee, right? So guys come in, guys go out. They don't drink the damn coffee, right? Until they come in with a bag of donuts or whatever. And then they drink the coffee. And they go, Neal, there's no coffee. I said, yeah, but I had the coffee all morning. And now it's gone bad. It's like cooking in the pot. Yeah, but it's no good. Fine. So I pour out the coffee, whatever was there, and I make a new pot of coffee. Then they drink it, and they say there was no coffee. Look, just because I run the studio, just because I'm about to hell with it, I make a third pot of coffee, right? And then they'd all eat each other's food. And then they'd complain to me, get the hell out of here or I'll bust you in the mouth and don't complain about your food. Put it in the put your name on the food. Well, put my name on the food, that's stupid. No, you're stupid. Don't come in here with food. Or if you do, eat it. And don't bring your girlfriend in. What's Russ Heath doing? What's Russ doing? He's on the phone. How long is he going to be on the phone? For about 2 hours? He's talking to a woman. Yes. Does he bring her up here? No. He just talks to her on the phone for 2 hours. We got to get work done. But each guy, a different thing. It's like a menagerie of crazy people. You can't. And I'm trying to run a studio and turn work out. You know, send it off, and they're all nuts. So no, there was. I mean, oh, is this guy a genius? Yeah, he's a genius. So what? He's a schmuck. Could they just come with no faults? You know, some angel come floating in. Just everything he does is right. No, it's just another schmuck. I'm just telling you. Jeff Jones changed his sex. I mean, who does that? I mean, you know, that's a wrong thing. Jeff, really? I just feel better this way. Okay, fine. It was crazy. Anyway,
there you go. Sorry. You said that nobody in continuity was ever your employee, but you did get these people work.
And I threatened their lives. The whole idea was nobody could come in that was stronger than me. See? Because I could just beat them up. That's what you do. Then they bring in, a bunch of guys brought in weights. Right? And they put them in the back of the studio so they'd work out, so they could be stronger than me. Very smart. So now I go back and I do the weights and I get stronger than them. That's okay. Good.
Well, at a certain point, a number of these guys, you were able to get them work doing advertising storyboards.
Yes.
You know, that work is something that I know at least a couple of them said, well, that paid for my house. That paid for my living. That's the reason I ate for years.
That's true.
At what point did this pivot become apparent as something that you needed to start looking for other revenue streams for yourself and for these turkeys who wouldn't work?
You have to understand. I'm an adult. Actually was an adult when I was 18 because I was poor. You know anybody who's poor or was poor? Become an adult really fast, don't you? Don't you? Because you're responsible. Whatever it is, it lands on you, you have to take care of it. So when you're poor, you have to make decisions based on being poor, and they have to be adult decisions. I was interested in science, engineering, and art. For science and engineering, I had to go to college. I couldn't afford to go to college. So art. Okay. I had to be good enough when I got out of high school to make a living. How do you do that? Well, you work 10 times as hard as anybody else. And so you get good. So I got out of high school as a professional. There's a bunch of books that are printed that I sign all the time. And if you find them, you'll see some of my sample pages when I was 18. They look professional. They were professional. So when I got out and I got into the field, I had choices to make. I was interested in doing comic books. In those days, they didn't let anybody do comic books. You guys may or may not know this. This is 1959. Okay, 1959, nobody got into comic books. In fact, if you ask around, there's nobody within 5 years of my junior or 5 years of my senior in comic books. Nobody's within 5 years. There are a couple of people that got in later, like Starenko, who was a magician, and then he became a comic book artist. And Denny O'Neill, who was a writer, and then began to write comic books. But there's nobody who got into comic books within 5 years my junior and 5 years my senior. I don't have contemporaries. There's nobody that's contemporary. For 10 years, they hired nobody. Nobody. And they didn't hire me. I did advertising comic books. And I was paid 4 times to 6 times as much as comic book guys were paid by doing advertising comic books. They got $50 a page. I got $200 and $300 a page. I did advertising storyboards, a little storyboard like this, $50. I could do 20 of these frames in a night. That's like doing a whole comic book in a night. What kind of a schmuck would do that and then do comic books at $50 a page? Okay, but my kids went to college and they made no loans, and they got out of college owing nobody any money because of comic books. Never. $50 a page, I'm sorry. Storyboard frames, $50 a frame. That's how they went to college. That's how all my kids went to college. Adults comport themselves this way. Why did I run the studio? Because in the end, I had a studio full of artists and I had advertising clients. The advertising clients paid 5 times as much money as comic book people. So the guys who worked in my studio, they would do comic books, but they would also do advertising because I would feed them work. And they would be paid 4 to 5 times as much money as they did doing comic books. And so they could buy a house, they could meet a girl, they could get married, they could have kids. Because when I started, and guys first started to come to do comic books, there was 4 guys in a shitty little apartment.
Texas, we're allowed to say it.
In a 4 guys in a crappy little apartment that had a wood floor that was so old and so rotten that if you bled on it, the blood would soak into the floor. And you did bleed onto it. Because we were rowdy. Just saying. Sorry. Anyway, so 4 guys in an apartment, by the same token, those guys, once they started to do advertising work, they could get apartments of their own. They couldn't do it back in those days. Nowadays, people get $300 and $400 and $500 a pencil page. Back in those days, $50 a page. Superman versus Muhammad Ali, $55 a page for pencils. You look at that comic book. Look at all the people and all the aliens and all the rest of it, $55 a page. I would go to an advertising agency and I would get $55. I would get $200 for a storyboard frame that big. And I get a lot of them. And that's how I put my kids through school. And that's how I paid for my apartment. And that's how we live like human beings, not from comic books. Comic books was a bad thing to do. So when I did advertising and then I finally had to come back into comic books, I came in back into comic books when they were hiring nobody. Not only were they hiring nobody, they didn't want to hire anybody. I had a room up at DC Comics and I put an autograph in the room. You guys know what an autograph is? It's an opaque projector. It shines down on your desk. You turn the light out and you put a photograph or a sketch in it and then you trace it onto your desk. I would hide guys out in that room. Howie Chaykin will tell you. They would hide in the room because I turned the light out. And so I would go out to the receptionist area, I'd meet the new young artist that no editors would look at, and I would say, come with me, and I'd take him into that room. And then when I talked to an editor, and they'd say, hey, we got a backup story, who are we gonna get for it? I would say, I happen to have a guy in my room that you might like to talk to. And it was Alan Weiss, or Bernie Wrightson, or Howard Chaykin. And I would introduce them to the editors because they were already in that room or in the lunchroom. They go between the lunchroom and my room. I would hide them out and force the editors to hire them because they were at a loss as to what to do to compete with Marvel. And none of them would hire new guys unless I said, use him. Use him. Use him. That's how stupid it was. In those days, I was giving up advertising work that paid 5 times as much money to hide guys out in my room to give them to editors, and I got $55 a page. Stupid. It was the stupidest time you could ever imagine. When they finally said, maybe we don't need you over here at DC Comics, I said, thank God I can get the hell out of here. Because now everybody knew was in. and now the editors were hiring. And now Julie Schwartz was used to the idea of hiring, and Murray Boltonoff was used to it, and Dick Giordano was used to it, and Joe Orlando was used to it, and I could leave, and all the problems were taken care of, except for the really hard problems. The return of original art, the royalties, the better reproduction methods. That I had to do out of DC Comics. You guys know about this stuff? You know anything?
You're the reason that DC has decent yellow, right?
I'm the reason that DC Comics prints on something better than toilet paper. When I started working for DC Comics, they printed with the reproduction method that Ben Franklin used. Ben relief printing. It's called relief printing. You get a metal plate, you put ink on the plate, and then you press the paper on it. And that's called relief printing. We don't print that way anymore. Ben Franklin did it that way. Ben Franklin. Okay? The worst kind of printing in the world. Relief printing. Okay? DC Comics and Marvel Comics printed that way. Housewives in Connecticut did the color separations, and DC Comics only had 32 colors. You know what I mean when I say 32 colors? You have no idea. 32 colors means you have 100% blue as a color, you have 50% blue as a color, that's dots. Then you have 25% blue as a color. Then you have 100% red, 50% red, and 25% red. And DC Comics only had 100% yellow, no tone yellow. So you couldn't print an Anglo-Saxon Protestant flesh like this, or yours, or not yours, but couldn't print that. Couldn't print it because there was no yellow to take the tone off the red. So everybody in those old comic books, you go check them in the other room. Pink skin, all their skin were pink. The only reason they didn't look that pink is the paper was so crappy that it added gray to the color, so it didn't look so pink. But when they reproduce those things, it's pink. It's ugly. Marvel Comics had tone yellow. I will tell you a story. Marvel Comics had, remember I told you, 100%, 50%, 25% blue, 100%, 25%, 50%, 20% red, only solid yellow with DC Comics. Marvel had solid yellow, 50% and 25% yellow. What that means, a little hard to figure out, that's 9 colors. If you multiply those together, you get 64 colors. You mix them together. DC Comics didn't have the two-tone yellows. That meant they had 32 colors. They had half as many colors as Marvel had. Unfortunately for Marvel, when black guys were printed, they did 25% yellow, 25% red, 25% blue, which meant gray, which meant Gage and the Howling Commandos had gray skin. Look it up, gray skin. Stupid, so much stupid. Anyway, it's gray skin, right? Anyway, the reason that even that the black guys in DC Comics had sort of brown skin was that they only had solid yellow, so it sort of had khaki colored skin. Light brown, which leads to another story, which I'm not going to tell you. So anyway, I'm coloring stuff at DC Comics, and I'm trying to get my pages through, and they only have 32 colors, and I go to production, I say, guys, we got to get tone yellow into these colors. We need aqua, we need all the good colors. No, it's too expensive. Saul Harrison, head of production, Saul, please, really, you got to get tone yellow. Really got it. Marvel has got tone yellow. No, too expensive. Really? Joe Kubert had become an editor. I went to Joe Kubert and I said, Joe, you know, I don't know if you know this, but you know Marvel has tone yellow.
Okay.
No, they don't. Yeah, they do. They have tone yellow. We don't have tone yellow. I don't think we have tone yellow. No, we don't. That's why we have pink flesh. Gee, that's weird. Are you sure? Look at the comic books. Talk to Saul. So he goes in and speaks to Saul Harrison. He comes out and he says, oh, if we got tone yellow, it would be too expensive. Really? Gee, you wouldn't think so. Because Marvel has it, and Marvel's cheap. Yeah, that's weird, isn't it? Does Jack Leibowitz, the president of the company, know that Marvel has tone yellow? They have twice as many colors as we have? I don't know. I'll go ask him. You do that, Joe. Joe goes in and asks Jack Leibowitz, skips over Carmine, goes to ask Jack Leibowitz, says, do you know, blah, 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 blah. I'm standing by Sal Harrison's office, and I'm looking down the hallway. Jack Leibowitz, in his gray suit and his pinstripe tie, comes storming down the hall. Sal! Come here! Sal Harrison comes out of his office. Does Marvel have this damn tone yellow? Crap. What do you mean? Well, I heard they have more colors than we have with this tone yellow stuff. Sal says, well, no, yeah, it's true. No, they have it, but it's more expensive. They pay more for it. That son of a bitch, Marvel pays more money for their color separation than I do? I'll be damned if that happens. Find out what the hell's going on. Sal Harrison, okay, gets on the phone and he calls the guy that does the color separations. Turns out the guy that does the color separations is the same guy that does it for Marvel and does it for DC Comics. Sal Harrison gets on the phone and he says, hey Joey, how much more would it cost us to get tone yellow? Oh. Okay. Yeah, give us the tone yellow. He turns to Jack Leibowitz, he says, they can give us the tone yellow. What's it gonna cost? The same amount. Joey was up in Connecticut going, I'm getting more money out of DC and I'm not even giving him tone yellow. On that day, DC Comics got tone yellow. 50%. That means they went from 32 colors to 64 colors overnight with one conversation. And I'm sitting on the side smiling. See, if you know something, if you know stuff, it's very hard for people to BS you if you know stuff. But you gotta know stuff.
One of the things that you've talked about a lot, I've asked you about, is fighting for creators' rights, royalties, original art. The twist on this that I wanted to ask you specifically, what was the most infuriating instance of having to advocate on somebody's behalf, whether it was Siegel and Schuster, whether it was a particular artist who wasn't getting their art returned to them? Was there one in particular that stood out to you that really made your blood boil the most?
Yes.
Are you willing to talk about it in public?
Yeah.
All right. You don't know with some of these. Sometimes they're fist fights. They're, you know, there's blood drawn. They're lawsuits.
I wanted to see a black character in comic books. And I didn't want him to be a gangbanger who suddenly got a superpower and decided he would become a superhero.
And just like all of us, right?
Yeah. Anyway. So I went to Sal Harrison. I said, not Sal Harrison, Julie Schwartz. Julie Schwartz is probably the best editor of comic books. And I said, Julie, we need another Green Lantern. Because something could happen to Hal Jordan. This is back when, I've got to remember. And he said, we have another one. We have a Guy Gardner guy. I said, okay, Julie, I'm sorry, I don't read the comics. I don't know what the hell you're talking about. It's Guy Gardner, and he pulls out one of his volumes because he had all his comic books put in the volume and gave me the volume and opened it up and it says, and he says, that's Guy Gardner, and he was blonde. Now he's got kind of orange hair, but he was blonde then. He was a blonde, white, Anglo-Saxon Protestant gym teacher. I said, okay. This is what I suggest. We hit him with a bus.
Most days I want Guy Gardner to get hit by a bus, actually.
So Julie said, why do you want to hit him with a bus? I said, well, you know, if you break his arm, he'll be back in a month and a half, but if you hit him with a bus, he'll have internal injuries and stuff. You know, he'd be really gone for a long time. We did, by the way, we hit him with a bus. You look it up. So, She said, why do you want to do this? I said, well, okay, Julie. And this alien comes down from space, right? He's going to die. Ibn Sur. And he's purple. And he knows he's going to die, so he sends out the ring to find the most worthy, bravest man on Earth to become the new Green Lantern. And the ring flies around the Earth. It passes by Batman, Superman, and all the heroes of the DC and Marvel Universe and finds a test pilot. I'm good with that. Test pilot, balls of steel. Chuck Yeager, probably the bravest man in the world. I would not go up in one of those things if you paid me $1 billion. Because they crash, you know, and you die. Chuck Yeager, you know. So to me, Hal Jordan becomes my Chuck Yeager. You know, I'm with that. So now you're going to send the ring out a second time and find the second bravest man on Earth. And the ring is going to go out and fly past Batman, Superman, and all the heroes of the DC and Marvel Universe and find Guy Gardner, a white Anglo-Saxon Protestant gym teacher in the Midwest. I'm sorry. The gym teacher? Really? That's it? Julie said, what's wrong with that? I said, oh, Julie, do you watch the Olympics? He said, I watch the Olympics. I said, well, how often do you see three white guys up there? You know, gold, silver, bronze. I mean, I see black guys, I see Asian guys. I rarely see three white guys. I see maybe an archery, you know, or I don't know, shot put or something. I'm just saying, I don't often see three white guys. I just, maybe it's me, but I don't see. He says, I could make him an Asian. I said, yeah, you could. But you know, you have this Asian guy in the Green Lantern comic book. You had him in there for like 10 years, and it's Hal Jordan's buddy, and you call him Pie Face. Well, we didn't mean that as a bad thing. No, you didn't mean it as a bad thing? Really? You call an Asian Pie Face? Let's bring 10 Asians in here and ask them if Pie Face is a nice thing to say to an Asian, because I don't think it is. Well, we didn't mean it that way. Well, you, I think you did. I think you did. No offense, but really, Pie Face, that's... He says, you want a black Green Lantern, don't you? I said, am I that shallow you can see through me like a puddle in the street? You just, am I that shallow, really? Yeah, I'd like a black Green Lantern. How about that? He said, fine. We'll get you a black Green Lantern. I said, no. I don't want a black Green Lantern. I want a college graduate who's got a profession. I don't want some gangbanger who suddenly becomes a good guy. I want a college graduate. And I want him to have a profession. Enough of this crap. He said, fine. He said, but you have to draw it. I said, Julie, not only do I have to draw it, as far as I know, I'm the only guy in the comic book business that knows how to draw black people. Even the black artists don't know how to draw black people because they've been trained to draw white people and then color them brown. Nobody knows how to do it. That's going to change. He said, fine. So gave the thing to Denny O'Neill to write. Fine. He's got the premise, everything's good. Denny's going to write. And I get the script. And I read the script. Sure enough, the guy's a college graduate. He's an architect. Later, they tell him he's a Marine, but then, first an architect. Anyway, so that's good. And on the first page, he's kind of tough. He's kind of good. And his name is Lincoln Washington. Huh? Lincoln Washington? I go to Denny. Denny, Lincoln Washington. Denny goes, not me. Julie picked the name. I go to Julie's room. I close the door, because there's gonna be some yelling. Said, Julie, Lincoln Washington. He says, what? I know lots of guys with names like that. Yes, and they're all changing their names, Julie. That is a slave name. Lincoln, you're out of your mind. line. This place is going to be filled with letters. Are you, you've gone out of your, just really, I'm not going to touch, I'm not drawing this book. He says, look, you pick a name. Pick a name. I said, not Lincoln Washington. He says, pick a name. Just you pick a name. Put names, Julie, put some names in a jar and pick a name out. He says, no, no, you pick a name. I said, John Stewart. How would I know he'd become a late night comedian? Who could know? You know, you get. So anyway, the story has two endings. I'm going to tell you the two endings. I'm going to tell you the second ending first. Second ending. Okay, happened recently, fairly recently. Second ending. They announced they're going to do a Hal Jordan Green Lantern movie, and all the kids in America go, who the hell is Hal Jordan?
Because they watch cartoons.
Because they watch cartoons. Because somehow DC Comics and Warner's equated selling 80,000 comic books to 100 to 10 million kids and adults watching Saturday and Sunday morning cartoons. We know John Stewart is Green Lantern, don't we? Don't we? Hello? This is the audience response part. Hello? Is John Stewart Green Lantern? We know Hal Jordan is Green Lantern. He's the original Green Lantern. But the guy on TV is John Stewart. And everybody knew it. So the kids in America went, who the hell is this Hal Jordan guy? John Stewart is Green Lantern. That's the first ending to the story. But oh, the end of that is they lost $150 million on that movie. $150 million. Is it because John Stewart wasn't in it? Maybe. Maybe. There been a lot of weird aliens in it. No John Stewart. This is the first ending to the story. Finish with this ending. Oh, maybe we'll do another question or two.
Yeah, wait.
Okay. This is the first ending. It happened a lot closer to doing the story. When you do coloring on a comic book back then, okay, you use the formula. Remember I told you 100%, 50%, 25%? So they used to, in those days, black people were always 100% yellow, 25% red, 25% blue, which is kind of a khaki light brown. So of course I didn't do that. I made it dark brown. 100% yellow, 50% red, 25% blue. Darker brown, nice dark brown. Of course, they didn't do that in those days. I know it's weird to talk about it now because they were weird days and things have changed, but that's how they did it. So anyway, Sol Harrison and Julie Schwartz come down the hallway looking for me because I had colored the book. And you not only color it, you also mark the formula for the color. So there's no way anybody can make a mistake. John Stewart, dark brown. So they come to talk to me. They say, Neal, we noticed this John Stewart character is kind of dark.
Turns out he is kind of dark.
Yeah, I said, yeah, that's right. Well, you know, we usually make a black character a light brown. I know that. Well, are you sure you don't want to? You can just change it with the numbers, you know. No, I don't think we'll change it. Now you sure? Because usually, I said, why don't we just leave it the way it is? It's fine. Now, Neal, you can. Are you sure? I think I'm sure. Leave it the way it is. And then I'm going to say something. Now you're going to listen to me say it. And you're not going to believe it, because this is today, and that was then.
Hold on to your seats.
But it was said to me then. Are you sure black people won't be offended? Sol, I think they've been offended for about 50 years.
Maybe no. Even more, who knows?
I said, but if you get a letter, give it to me. I'll be glad to answer it. Anyway, yeah, there were times that I was offended when I did comic books, but only by stupidity, and that was pretty stupid. So, do you have any questions?
Who
We've got a few minutes for a couple of questions. If you want to see Neal over at his table and purchase one of his lovely yes. comic books prints, omnibus,
most especially do that.
Please do that.
Oh, and the Green Lantern, Green Arrow series is there in a book form. It's a little expensive, but it's all together.
It's gorgeous, though. Actually, I should ask you about that. In terms of printing this stuff, that we'd say the original printing process on it wasn't so glorious. What has it been like going back through this stuff that they've been remastering and reworking and redoing the color digitally on?
What's it like? It's good. It's good. I mean, really, it's good. Do you have any questions? It's good, yeah.
Hop up to the mic. Microphone right there.
Yeah, okay. I didn't hear, but yeah, sure. How do you feel about the sort of new independent comic book labels that are coming out? Your opinions about that? You know, like, Dark Horse? I encourage the independent labels. I want to see it happen more and more. Not only do I want to see it happen more and more, I want to see those things turn into movies and television shows so people can make the kind of money that DC and Marvel makes. Because I'm just a little pissed at how much money DC and Marvel is making and not sharing it. They share a certain amount, but it's a very small amount. But let's say Hellboy, you got Hellboy, okay? There's an artist and a writer, Mike Mignola, who is sharing the big apple. He's getting the right proportion. And that's what we want to see in this industry. We're going to move toward independent, sort of like a film, the film industry. You have independent filmmakers and independent movie stars going out and making the right amount of money for the work that they do, and it's not necessarily going to the film companies. So, and the film, and DC and Marvel had better watch out, because all of their good people are going to go away, and they're going to be left with what's left, and they better. And I believe DC is paying attention to that. Unfortunately, they're making lousy movies, but still, they got their eye on the ball as far as the creatives are concerned, and so they're doing better creative stuff. So their sales are actually going up. Marvel making great movies, but they treat their people kind of shitty. But that'll change. It's gonna change. I started a ball rolling when I got back into the comic book business, but not because I'm so unique and wonderful, but because somebody needed to start making the changes. Those changes are inevitable. It's sort of like freedom. Once you start it rolling, it doesn't stop. It just keeps on going. So we don't need Neal anymore, because now everybody gets it.
We've got a couple of program notes here before we wrap up. Right here on the Q&A stage, coming up at 4 o'clock, Hacksaw Jim Duggan, 5 o'clock, Kathy and Jimmy, and then 6 o'clock, the costume contest. Neal, do you have anything particularly new and shiny that has arrived
no,
in the shop that's
just
over there?
Keep your eye on what I'm doing.
Get over there, Browns.
You will see Continuity Comic Books coming back again, for those of you who are interested.
Anything public here like that you can talk about?
I'm going to be doing Dead Man for 6 issues, and maybe 12 issues as the what I'm doing with. I'm going to tell you a secret, okay? I shouldn't tell you this, okay? But if any of you are interested in the creative end of this business, you have to use your head, okay? It's important to use your head. It's important when you write contracts. It's important when you read contracts. It's important. Don't let somebody give you a piece of paper and you sign it that day, you sign it later, and you speak to somebody else, or a lawyer, or a smart uncle, or whatever. But use your head when you do any of this stuff, because you also have to be businessmen, and unfortunately they don't teach it in art school, okay? So you need to do that. I'm going to tell you something about the contract I have with DC Comics. It's called a Favored Nations Contract. Now I'm going to show you how evilly stupid and wonderful I am. And it's a favorite. Now, how would I know to say favored nations? Does anybody here know what that means? Anybody? Okay, good. It's bad, but good. What's a favored nations contract? What it means is they're going to pay me the top rate that they pay. Now let's just, you're going to get Neal Adams, you're going to give him a contract, you're going to give him the top rate, right? Right? Say yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, you better. You're going to give him the top rate. Or he'll bitch at you.
You'll never hear the end of it.
Right,
it will never end.
Right, you'll never hear the end of it.
But along with that contract, you're going to say, but Neal Adams will have favored nation status and will be treated as a favored nation. Now, what does that mean? That means that if anybody at DC Comics gets a raise, rate-wise, I get it. Okay, so let's just say I'm paid, we'll make up a number, $914 a page. Random number. For pencils, okay? Let's say somebody comes along that they want to have work for them, okay? Who is Frank Miller or Jim Patterson or somebody. They want to have work for them. And that person demands $1,300 a page. And they get it. I get it. As soon as they get it, I get it. Nobody can get more than me. I am a favored nation. Okay? Would you like to know the look on their face when they discovered that they were paying somebody else more than me, and now they had to raise my rates by 50% without even realizing it, forgetting the contract, then looking it up in the contract and going, oh my God, we have to pay Neal the same as we pay Jim Patterson or whatever. And so now I get that number. You want to have a good contract with somebody who's got a lot of money? Get a favored nation's contract. Learn about your business and how you comport yourself, and you'll do better. Stay ignorant, don't get good advice, and you get trampled on like everybody else. Seriously. I know you're a small group, but this should be said to everybody in the industry. Learn more about business. My rates overnight went up 50% because of that. 50%. Actually, it's a stupid amount when you think about it. 50%. Ladies and gentlemen, he will be here the rest of the weekend. Go see him at his table. Let's hear it once more for Neal. Watch your back, Adams.